Hello and welcome back. If you follow the channel, you already know that my HP 9825, famously used by Mr. Fancy Pants in the HP catalog, recently died from a power supply failure that caused an overvoltage. The 5 volts temporarily became 13 volts, which is a big ouchie if you are a TTL chip. In the previous episodes, we were able to repair the 3 main boards, some with the help of the original designers. We even found and interviewed Mr. Fancy Pants, who is none other than Bob Stern, Keysight's principal metrologist emeritus. After many adventures, we finally got the 9825 to boot again, but only when we used the keyboard and display assembly from another 9825. Time to repair our keyboard display printer assembly, or KDP as it is known. This has us very worried though, because it uses a proprietary chip as its main IC. If that one is toast, there is little we can do to find a new one.
So it's time we return back to our HP 9825, which we had left on the side to do other things for a while. And then this time Ken is helping me out because Carl is off to Florida. So
I'm the next best thing.
Yeah. Exactly. And I am all set. I have my fancy pants on, so, and the teletype t-shirt, so nothing can resist me anymore. So on this one, we know there's one fault. We don't know how much is not working, but we know at least the reset key is not working, because when we booted it up, it took the wrong branch, so the reset key was pressed and it was not.
Should we show people the key?
This one, reset key. And can you explain that we're a little bit lucky here and we think we understand the circuitry?
So it basically has a resistor capacitor delay to generate a pulse when you press the reset key using these chips. And we were afraid that it went into this magic MOS chip that would buffer it, but it turns out it's connected pretty much directly to the I/O bus.
The branch down here, that's the one I was concerned about for the register read. I thought it was going to go in the big unknown chip, but no, it gets straight on the line here and goes out through the BIB, which is the interface chip. So it looks like the main chip and the HP chip is not involved in this. Man, which would be great, right? Because then it's just straight TTL, and it should be fairly straightforward to figure it out. So it's a two people operation to test the switch. I'm pretty sure that was that.
There we go.
Okay, so it's not our key. Our key is good, it's as we suspected. Is the circuit afterward, which aren't that many, right? A Schmidt trigger and an inverter and an AND gate, so that should not be too hard. So we set ourselves up for just powering the plus 5 volts, because we only need to check the TTL section, and then I was just going for it, 5 volts, and it's already over current. So we might have a hot chip in there. Okay, so we are at 1 amp, and thermal camera would be better, but the finger test still works. This one, and that one, so we have two that are fairly hot, and one that's a little tepid. All right, so those are normal things.
So U7 is the inverter for the, I think, the address coming in.
Uh-huh.
And then U11, I have not found, it's over here in...
It's just standard TTL. Okay, first one. S00. Oh, yeah, I can already see it.
What?
It melted. That pin. Oh, you can see it on the PCB. Yes, that's the one that suffered. But that might be good. It might have protected the board. You can see it right here.
Huh.
It melted. Okay, which gives me a chance to show you the Tantec board that I just built. It interfaces to a terminal window in a good old-fashioned way. S00, if I print in the thing, S00. We found S00, and you just do T to test. And it gives you a ton of info. And the first thing that you note is that the current is way high. It's 90 milliamps, right? Which is why it was getting hot. And so all the voltages are too high. It doesn't work at all. Okay, next, the two one that didn't, that look suspicious on the finger test are two LS04. So let's test the first one. This one also is bad. It's bad. Feels hot, but I'm not sure. In the tester it goes. And off we go. S04. Found it. Test. Yeah, chip looks okay. And then another one. That's the second one. All right. Okay. So the second chips are good, Ken. So I don't know why they are hot. They say it's only 4.9 milliamps. So I put my, actually those were LS04, that's why they were so low power, and my S00 brand new one, also from HP collection, so an original one in. DC out. No, it still goes into overvoltage, into overcurrent. Yeah, it goes into amps. There's more than one bad chip on there. Well, the one that was burning before is not anymore.
What about the printer? Is it taking any current?
It could. Or it could be the displays, right? The displays might be very power hungry. I see nothing hot on the board, though. I can take the display out. Aha, yeah, it's the display. It is the display, and might be the printer too. But the printer has plenty of stuff on it. Let me try the good keyboard and see what the power consumption is on that one. And we will know if we need to worry or not. Dang, if there's something on the display, then... Well, no, the display is just LEDs, so... So this is our good display board, so we... See what the reference is. It consumes a lot of current too. And let me take out the display and see if it goes to 800 milliamp, which is what I had on the other board. So let's try this. No, it goes to 400 milliamps. Not 800 milliamps. Okay. So I removed the printer and the display, and the good keyboard is at 210 milliamps when it's like this. And this one is at 640. So we have 400 and, or 630, we have 420 milliamps that go somewhere where it shouldn't go. I know where it goes. Is the chips here that we just tested good? I put back. They're super hot. What? And there's another one here that's hot. So what do you think, Master Ken? If it's the chip consumes a lot when it's on the board, but it's okay when it's out of the board, it's what it's connected to?
Yeah, it seems like it's trying to output high and something is trying to pull it to ground.
Yeah.
Or vice versa.
And they get connected to the KDP chip, which was kind of scary. The KDP is pulling them to plus, but they still, some of them are connected to UH, which feels hot too. Warm, not hot. Ken actually looked up the LS04.
So it says short circuit output current can be up to 100 milliamps.
So it would only take two pins that short circuit it.
Yeah.
And that could explain the extra 100 milliamp. Okay, so it's what they are connected to, which would be the LS08 or the KDP chip. Okay, so I'm going to pull the chips that it's shooting into. Okay, the chip is in the socket, it's a 7425, but unfortunately It is an order 25, so can't test it. So the 25 is not a usual chip. It's a four input NOR with a control gate. It's a gated four input NOR. But now I removed it and my board is back to normal consumption. So I lost the extra 60 milliamps. So I guess it has to do with it. Unfortunately, I don't have an extra one of these, which is a bit of an issue. Okay, but finally, we have the board paired up without drawing any extra current, so we can finally, even without waiting for the circuit and the 7425, we can do what we wanted to do in the first place, is check what the reset does. And it's a very simple circuit, right? You have a switch that will discharge the capacitor to ground. So you expect this to go progressively down, and then when that goes down, the thing will go up sharply. It's an inverter with hysteresis. This will take a while to go up, so it's going to do another thing like that, and this is going to go down with a little bit of delay compared to this. We should have here two different pulses, so if I put them in time, there should be this one and it should be that one, and then the output should be that, right? Out in one, in two. Let's power the thing up. No, it doesn't blow up anymore. And then let's test the transition. Let's see if this works as we thought it would. Give it a good contact. And so you can see this charges. It triggers the Schmitt trigger at some point, and then it triggers the second one with a little bit of delay. So here we should have had a pulse in the other direction, but it's already at zero, so we saw nothing. So yeah, we got one more circuit that's bad, and that is U17. So okay, I actually have to apologize to my LS03 because that's in open collector. I forgot that. So in order to make the open collector to work, you need a pull-up resistor to pull it up to the plus. And if I trigger it on the event, there you go, there's my reset pulse. So no, the LS03 was fine. It's just an open collector that is loaded probably by the other board. It's not loaded on this board, so I needed to add the load resistor. So the reset is fine. I just need to get the new 7825. So for now, only two bad circuits in that board. The 74S00 and the 7425. So we found that the 7425 was hard to get, and the only place I could get it is from Marcel. He had everything.
So 25. The 7425, it's two 4 input NOR gates, which seems straightforward enough, but then they add a strobe. And that's an extra input called G, and if G is low, then your output is high, no matter what the rest of the NOR gate is doing.
And this is a working chip, or this is our dead chip?
This is the dead chip. The strobe works nicely.
Okay.
But now if we start pulling inputs of the NOR gate, so now I'm going to pull it high with this wire, and if I pull the first one high, nothing happens. If I pull the second one high, our power supply overloads. So Basically these inputs are hard shorted to ground, and it overloads the power supply if I try to pull it high.
So I replaced the 7425, and I'm going to see if it powers up at the same amperage as the good board. It was 210 milliamps. 210! Okay. So now our good board and our formerly bad boards behave the same. So At least it tells me there's no circuit with extra power consumption in that one, so the TTL might be good. Yeah, so we put back the keyboard together, and there's still many things that we didn't check that could go wrong. The display in particular, we didn't check the printer and the tape. But let's see if it boots, I guess that's the next step, right? Any better idea, Ken?
Let's see what happens.
All right.
Is that good or bad?
That is not good. Okay, I have a bad feeling about that, because the way this works, there's an oscillator here, which is actually one of the first CMOS gates for 4001. And followed by an amplifier with a suppressor. So either the suppressor doesn't work or the gates are bad, but we know the oscillator works, we heard it. And it can be suppressed this way, but it also can be suppressed by the KDP. Actually, that's how it beeps. When this is plus, this gate will work as an inverter, it will beep. When this is tied to zero, it will not beep. And I can reproduce this here. I have disconnected the beep pin, and that's the other end of 4001. And if I turn it on, it just beeped because it got the 60 hertz. So that's tied to the ground. Tied to the ground. Plus. And that's that was 60 hertz mixed with the beep. So the beeping circuit works. Well, let's put it back in the machine with the spin off, so at least it won't beep at us. But we might have our KDP dead. Okay, back at it with the beep pin of the KDP out of its socket. I checked that the machine boots fine with the good keyboard, so it's not plugging the keyboard wrong. This is all fine, and it shouldn't beep. So it doesn't beep, and it doesn't boot at all. And at this point, I am like, ouch, the KDP might be completely zapped. Ooh, that would not be good. Oh no, this is disappointing. I really hoped we could revive it in this episode. But you know us, we don't give up that easily. We'll try harder in the next episode and fight further with the KDP chip and psychedelic LEDs. See you then.
So Mark, did you get the keyboard running?
That will be the next step, right? To get the
it's got a KDP chip on it. That's a custom ASIC for the keyboard and display and printer.
So this one I'm really worried about.